Happy Sabbath, people. Welcome to church this morning and welcome to those online. Would you please stand with us as we sing our opening song?
Something good's about to take place.
Standing for our opening prayer. Dear Lord, we ask for your grace and mercy and strength to pour amongst our pathfinders and adventurers participating in your service, as well as to bless our congregation and those who are watching online. In your precious name, amen. You may be seated. Happy Sabbath and welcome to Pathfinder and Adventurer Day. This is the Lord, this is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Through this service, our pathfinders and adventurers will take part and showcase all of their talents and hard work they have developed over the course of the 2023-2024 Pathfinder Adventure Year. Please remain seated for the processional. Color guards, forward march. Pathfinders and adventurers, forward march! Color guards, halt. Pathfinders and adventurers, halt. Pathfinders and adventurers, right and left face. Please rise as we recite the Pledge of Allegiance to the American flag. Pathfinders and adventurers, present arms.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which we stand, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Pathfinders and adventurers, order arms. Let us recite the pledge of the Bible.
The pledge of the Bible, God's holy word, I will make a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path, and I will hide its word in my heart so I might not sin against God.
We will now recite the adventure pledge in law.
Jesus can help me to be obedient, be pure, be true, be kind, be respectful, be attentive, be helpful, be cheerful, be thoughtful, be reverent.
Because Jesus loves me, I will always do my best.
We will now recite the Pathfinder Pledge and Law.
Please put your hands over your hearts. By the grace of God, I'll be pure and kind. I'll keep the Pathfinder law, be a servant of God and a friend to man.
The Pathfinder law is for me to keep my honest word, keep my honest word. Be careful of my body, keep a level eye, be courteous and obedient, walk carefully in a sanctuary, keep a song in my heart, and go on God's errands.
Let us now sing the adventurous song.
We are adventurers, at home, at school, at play, we are
now sing the Pathfinder song.
Oh, we are the Pathfinder strong, the servants of God are we, faithful as we march along, in kindness, truth, and purity, a message to tell to the world, a truth.
Guards, post colors. Color guards, right face.
Happy Sabbath, Seabrook. I'm going to say that one more time. Happy Sabbath, Seabrook. Okay. It is so wonderful to see you here on this exciting Pathfinder Adventure Day. I also extend a special greeting to those watching online. It is so nice that you are with us. A warm welcome to one and all. We are glad that you are here as we explore the theme, Little Becomes Much. My name is Desna St. Louis Bell, and I proudly but humbly serve as the director of the Seabrook Stingray Adventurer Club. The Adventurer Club introduces children ages 2 through 9. Actually, this year we have 2 1-year-olds joining us, right? And, you know, the 9-year-olds who started as 9-year-olds, some of them are now 10 years old, so I need to acknowledge that, okay? But through tonight to Jesus and helps them learn about the world around them while also learning more about themselves. This year, our club has grown to a steady membership of 56 energetic young people who journey through 6 classes, namely Little Lamb, Eager Beaver, Busy Bee, Sunbeam, Builder, and Helping Hand. Teaching and caring for these precious little ones are 14 hardworking and warm staff. Adventurous staff do big things, and they also do little things that mean so much to our children. Adventurous staff, can you please stand to be recognized? And we also have 3 staff members in the praise team. Thank you. We also have the most amazing parental support. Our parents want our club, hence their children, to be successful, so they pour into it. It is so heartwarming to see many daddies involved. We are a family hub here. Thank you so much, parents. Can you wave, adventurer parents? Okay. This past year, we completed 2 major outreach activities, which included designing and sharing Christmas cards with 45 families right here in this neighborhood. We also went international by collecting and packing items to send to children overseas through the partnership with Operation Christmas Child. The kids worked hard to pack 64 shoeboxes to share with less fortunate kids, and I think that is very good. We have continued to grow our adventurer choir, and the children enjoy singing about Jesus and his love every single club meeting. Tomorrow, we will enjoy a family fun day with other clubs in the Potomac Conference. In everything we do, we practice teamwork, show our creativity, and share happiness with others. We may be small in stature, but we have big hearts. And we know Jesus takes the little we can do and makes it much in service to others. Thank you for being with us today. May God bless you as we worship together. Thank you.
Amen. Amen. Good morning again, everyone. My name is Donna Staten, and I have the privilege of being the director for the Seabrook Seahawks Pathfinders. I want to say I don't do this by myself. We have a staff, a fascinating staff, young and old. At this time, I'm going to ask the staff to stand, the staff of the Seabrook Seahawks to stand. Please stand. Thank you, and this is not all. I'm so grateful once again that God has seen it fit for me to be in this place and doing this. And I'm thankful to you parents for entrusting your children to us. At this time, I want to welcome, we have some visiting clubs with us this morning. I'd like to welcome them. Restoration Praise Center, are you here? Can you please stand? Thank you. Thank you for being with us. And the Pennsylvania Avenue Pathfinders, are you here? Once again, thank you for being here. Thank you for visiting with us. Any other visiting clubs that I missed? And is our era coordinator here? Althea, is our area coordinator here? I don't see her yet. But I want to extend a special warm welcome to you this day. We have the privilege this past year of realizing the significance of little things. Hence our theme, little means much. And we've been focusing on little things. And you'll hear more from our preachers as we enter into the sermon. Our Pathfinders are learning the significance of the little things. Sometimes we miss the little things and the effect, or just, you know, little things, a smile, etc., can mean a lot to someone. We have such a courageous group of Pathfinders. You guys heard some of them, just a part of them on the drum corps. I want to brag because last Sunday we had the Potomac Conference drill drum competition, and our drum corps placed second place. Under the directorship of area coordinator, our own Melvin Hostin. So for the drill competition, I really didn't register, you know, us for the drill competition because we were having challenges with commitment and basically doing our drills. And 2 weeks before the competition, a couple of certain Pathfinders, so Ms. Donna, we really want to do this. So of course I called, and yes, I registered late, and they competed and they came in first place. So they're led by our own Isaiah Graf. Isaiah, are you in here yet? They're with the drum corps. So you guys notice in the hallway, in the lobby, we have various trophies. That's a lot of hard work, okay? And please take time to look at our trophies, our accomplishments, also some of the work that we've done in our investiture class. And I want you to be proud of your own Seabrook Seahawks and continue to support us as we move forward this year and move forward to Gillette, Wyoming for our international camporee. At this time, we're gonna lead into our opening song, number 614.
The battle cry, see the foe's line, raise the standard high for the Lord. Gird your armor on, stand firm, everyone. Rest your cause upon his holy word. Rouse then, soldiers, rally round the banner. Ready, steady, pass the word alone. Onward, forward, shout aloud, Hosanna.
Amen. Indeed, the Lord is captain and king. Amen. And we want to come before our king today. We praise God for our young people, for the Pathfinders and Adventurers, and the leadership. And we're looking forward to the ministry that God is going to bring forth through our youth today. Let's take a moment to just seek our Lord and our God. Whatever burden you may have, some are dealing with grief today. Some may be dealing with other hardships, be they financial or family. Whatever they may be, we know that God is able. Amen, somebody. God is able, and we're going to bring it to a God who cares, who hears, and who is answering our prayers. We're going to have Brother Michael Wanguma pray for us. It's time. You may kneel or bow reverently or just sit in your seats where you are. If someone wants to come to the front, you may do so at this time as well.
Within your will, may you all please stand for the congregational prayer. Pathfinders and Adventurers, parade rest and prayer attention. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this wonderful Sabbath day that you have given to us. Thank you for allowing us to live once more so that we can see another beautiful Sabbath that you have created for us. Lord, I want to pray for anyone who is going through a time of distress at this moment. I ask that you may send your Holy Spirit to comfort them and let them know that you will always be with them no matter what. And along with this, I pray for those who are going through a time of joy, because I know, and we all know, that you are rejoicing with them. I also pray for the prosperity of the church, that you may help us not to be people who judge others, but people who invite others into your holy house, and allow us to serve others, to empower others, and to invite people to do the same. I ask that you forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all wickedness, and allow us to leave this place and give us a fresh start and allow us to be ready for the next week, full of challenges, trials, tribulations, and temptations. And by your grace, we know that we can power through it all. I ask all of this in your heavenly name, I pray. Amen. Pathfinders and Adventurers, attention. You all now may be seated.
gets on our cars and outdoor toys and sometimes makes people sneeze. Speaking of pollen, let me see if you guys know what kind of trees and vines that we have to show you today. So can anyone guess what this is?
Flowers.
Yes, those are flowers. Let's see. Those are flowers on an apple tree.
Apple.
Yes, there you go. Does anyone know what this is?
Avocado.
Avocado. Good job, boys and girls. Can anyone tell me what they think this is?
Flowers.
Eggplant. Good guess, good guess. That's a blue, this our blueberry tree. Yes. Okay, what do you guys think this is? Cherry blossoms. What grows on cherry blossoms? Yes, there we go. So what do you guys think this is? Any guesses? These are grapes. Yes. Okay, what do you guys think this is? I'll give you another hint. What does this look like? Green grapes, a pear, okay. And those are mangoes. You guys are all really smart. Other than being yummy, guess what all these foods have in common? Yes, we know they're foods. Do y'all know what this is?
Okay, did you know that bees do a lot to help people? For one, as the bees are smelling the flowers and flying around admiring all the pretty bright colors, the bees get a little pollen or plant dust on their body and take the pollen to the next flower. And that's how we get seeds for all these yummy foods.
Something as little as a bee can be used by God. Bees are important for our food, and God has made them to do so much more for us. So this spring and summer, when you see a bee, stay away from it so they can do their jobs. But thank God for all the bees. Lastly, guess who else is small but can be a helper for God? You all. You saw a bee? Wow, that is so cool. Oh my. That is so cool, boys and girls. So right now, after I pray, we're gonna let you help us collect the offering for Christian education. So bow your heads as we pray. Dear God, thank you for bringing us all here safely to worship you. Let us take something from this sermon and apply it to our everyday lives. In your name, amen. So now we're gonna give you all bags to go collect money for Christian education. One at a time.
I am a promise. I am a possibility. I am a promise with a capital P. I am a great big bundle of potentiality.
I am a great big bundle of potentiality.
Praise God. We have a special part of the program now. We have a baby blessing today. So I'm going to invite the Goff family to come on up. Janice, bring Genevieve Goff up today. Family, friends, supporters, come on up at this time. There they are in the back. Sister Janice is bringing her little one, Genevieve Goff, to be blessed today. Amen. And if you would like to schedule a baby blessing, you can contact the church office. You'll talk with our office administrator, Eve Brunson, and she will be able to help schedule that special event. All right, the Goff family. Looking at the mic for a minute. Come on up, family. Oh yeah, you got plenty of support here. Come on and fan on around. Yeah, you're gonna fill up the stage. All right. Well. And more still coming. All right, come on. Praise God. Good. Well, well, well. All right. We're not going to keep Genevieve waiting. She looks nice and patient right now, but that may not last long. Praise God, family. Praise God. We know this family. And I just want to share just a brief word. You know, Proverbs 22 and verse 6. Train up a child in the way she should go. And when she is old, what? Come on. She will not depart from it. Right? And I don't know if we really consider how deep that passage really is. You know, I was talking to my wife. I was sitting on the edge of the bed. I was talking to my wife about something. It was a good conversation, whatever it was. And I was sitting on the bed, and we were talking, and then she said, "Your dad does that." And I said, "What?" And she said, "Rubbing his legs like that when he's talking." And I looked, and I said, "That sure is what I'm doing. I'm rubbing my legs just like Dad used to do." And I've heard it said, you know, you that's exactly what your mother would say. She would. That's exactly how she would say it. And there are people I know very well who the last person they want to be like is their mother or their father, and they act exactly like them. Anybody know what I mean? Exactly like them. What's my point? My point is that when you hear that, train up a child in the way she should go, and when she's old, she will not depart. A lot of times we do that. Most of that we do unconsciously. We don't even know. We. It's not just we're giving them information that we want them to remember when they're old. We're literally, as we raise children, riveting patterns of thinking and behavior into their brain that when they get old, it's almost irreversible. They're going to act and to think in a certain way based on the way we raise them. So the text is really saying, be conscious about how you are training them. The words you say, the way you talk, the way you relate to the child, the way you relate to each other, village, aunts, uncles, godparents, all of that. Be conscious about it. Train up a child, way to go. And when she is old, she will not depart from it. Right, right. Oh, she's listening. She's looking at the mic too now. She's looking at the mic. Let's see. Come on, Leslie. And I'll have the other mic. Hold it. Look out there at the church, girl. Look at you. Come on, give the Lord a hand for this beautiful bundle of joy. Y'all can tell she's real smart, right? Besides being beautiful, she's smart. Genevieve Goff. I have a special affinity for that name. My grandmother's name is Genevieve. Genevieve. Okay, girl, let's pray. Let's pray. Oh, God, 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 we bring Genevieve to you today. Look at all the support, Lord. I just thank you that you put her in the right family. You put her in a loving village, oh God. Her dear mom, Janice, Lord, we love her, God. She is just a blessing, and you gave her to the right parent. Lord, her aunts and godmother and grandmother and all the family, Lord, we just give you praise. And we thank you, Lord, for this gift that you have given us. And Lord, we just lift her up before you. She's already exhibiting just traits of a brilliant individual. Bright, smart, happy, joyful. You've blessed her with health, oh God, and we just praise you and thank you for that, Lord. And Lord, we want to see her continue to grow and to develop and to move closer and closer to the great plan that you have for her. For we know, God, that you brought her in this world for a purpose. And so, Lord, we ask, God, that you will work through this family, work through her mom, work through the loved ones, Lord, in this village here, Lord, and this wider church village to lead her and guide her to the plan and to the purpose and the destiny that you have for her, Lord. We thank you, Lord, and we present her to you, Lord, in the name of Jesus, trusting, oh God, that you will guide, that you will protect, and Lord, that you will see her through even the darkest hours. And Lord, let us remember the admonition in the word, train up a child, but Lord, do it intentionally, consciously, knowing, oh God, that you are guiding us as we guide her. Lord, we give you the praise once again, and we submit her unto you, lay her on your altar, as it were. We present her as your own. Anoint her for the purpose you have for her. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen, amen, amen. She got a little restless at the end, but that's all right. All right, our family life leader will present something to the family.
Praise the Lord, everybody. It's exciting to see this free babysitting club you have behind you. All right? Thank you, Jeannie. Thank you for allowing and converting this congregation into a village to let your child grow so that she can be a part of children's ministry. She can be a part of adventurers and pathfinders. Amen. That she can understand the fundamental values that your mom placed in you, and you turned out pretty good. So hey, God bless you. On behalf of the church, we have a gift. It's a book called Child Guidance. Now I'm going to ask Elder Hammond to stand. You see that lovely young lady right there? She does a growth group 5 o'clock every Sabbath afternoon to a conference call on that book. So you're welcome to join every Saturday afternoon 5 o'clock, Child Guidance. And this is a certificate, proof that you are here. God bless you all as we worship today.
Amen. Amen, church.
One of the special things about being a Pathfinder director is being able to celebrate the highs. And this year, we had a few highs. our PBE team for Pathfinder Bible Experience, some of you may know as Bible Bowl, made it to the conference level. All three teams. And yes, that is something to be applauded. It's not just about competition, it's about them studying, literally studying the Bible, reading scriptures, memorizing scriptures, and being able to do this. And at this time, I'm gonna ask them to stand, and I'm gonna ask their head coach, Coach Laura, Coach Carla, Coach Sherlin, and the Bristols, and also the other parents that helped. I'm gonna ask them to stand along with the PBE participants. I am so proud of them and so proud of all the effort. They're already starting to prepare for next year's Pathfinder Bible Experience. Another thing that, you guys may be seated, sorry. Another thing that I want to recognize today, you guys notice, I don't know if you notice, but there's some young adults who were once adventurous pathfinders who are now leading out. And I want to take the time to celebrate them. So behind me, I have this is a few, come on up, Lemuel also. These are the Pioneer Navigator class. So Pathfinder typically extends to the 10th grade at Seabrook because we have young people who are interested in being in Pathfinder, even with their busy high school schedule, 11th and 12th grade. We are privileged to have the Pioneer Navigator class. And yes, they are leaders. They have been to leadership training. And I rely on them for their input, their help, their suggestion. And most of all, I'm training my replacement because I have no intentions of doing this forever. So I want to take the opportunity to have you guys applaud, and also on the front row, we have the adventurer staff, the young adventurer staff. I'm going to ask you guys to stand. Because there's a saying that if you don't have young people, young leaders in your church, then what's next? Okay, so I want to take this time to applaud you guys and let you know I appreciate you guys. So I don't know if there's anybody here at Seabrook who don't know Sister Ponder. Well, this year Sister Ponder is celebrating an anniversary. 55 years in Pathfinder ministry. And I'd like her to come forward at this time and be recognized. Thank you. I can't begin to tell you how much of a mentor, support, and just everything Sister Ponder has been to me and also to our Pathfinder ministry. She teaches the Friends class, which is the beginning class of Pathfindering. And those of you who have been through, who have Pathfinders who have been through the Friends class, you know the drill, you know the routine. She's no nonsense. Usually once they get through the Friends class, okay, we know they've mastered the basics. And so Sister Ponder, it's such a privilege to be working alongside you. And it's I'm so blessed to have you, not just in this ministry, but to have you in my life. And we want you to know that publicly. And so at this time, we just wanna give you just a small something to let you know that we appreciate you and we love you and we look forward to having you for a long, long time doing what you do and love. Okay. And I want those of you sitting out there to take a page out of her book. Those of us in our Pathfinder uniforms also to take a page out of Sister Ponder's book. Thank you so much, Sister Ponder. We love you.
Before Donna and Deputy Director Keith have a seat, just wanted to say thank you to them. They have sacrificed so much to keep this Pathfinder Club going. We appreciate you so, so much. The money that you spend of your own, the time that you take, it's a whole lot. So we appreciate you all working together to keep this club going. A little something from us. You're welcome.
It's time to praise. Praise God for what he has done and for who he is. So let's lift our hands in the sanctuary. Give him honor and glory and praise. Come on.
We lift our hands in the sanctuary.
We lift our hands. but you created me to worship daily. So I'ma leave it all right here. Help me say yes.
You did not create me to worry. You did not create me to fear. But you created me to worship daily.
Word is true.
Happy Sabbath, Seabrook. The scripture reading is taken from Luke 16, 10 through 11. Please stand. Verse 10, he who is faithful in what is least is faithful also in much, and he who is unjust in what is least is unjust also in much. Verse 11, therefore, if you have not been faithful in the unrighteous mammon, who will commit to your trust the true riches? May the Lord add a blessing to the reading and understanding of his word. You may be seated.
This morning, I have the awesome privilege of introducing our three Pathfinder speakers. So I had no problems with them hesitating about whether or not they wanted to speak. And I'm grateful for the opportunity for them to be here. And they have a special message for you. I want to thank Pastor Johnson for taking the time to meet with them and to coach them. So the first speaker is going to be Kia Cully. She's a rising 11th grader. She loves animals and nature, and she's aspiring to be a veterinarian. Kia loves a challenge. She enjoys reading the Word of God and sharing about His goodness to all. She is seldomly shy, even though we may think that she's an introvert. However, for those who are close to her, such as her siblings, know her as being a ball of fire and lots of energy. Kia is currently in the guide class in Pathfinders. Our second speaker is going to be David Eheglio. Now, David is in the Friends class. He was born on July 11th in Hartford, Connecticut, to Eklu and Adjo Eheglio. He has a little brother named Michael, who is in our adventurer club. David is in the fifth grade, and his favorite subjects are math, writing, and social studies. Be impressed with this. David is the author of more than five short stories that he shares with his friends and family. Most of all, David loves the Lord and enjoys learning about him. He had a great first year in PBE and can't wait to go to division next year. He wants to be a writer when he grows up, so he can continue to spread the love of Jesus around him. And our next speaker is one of Seabrook's own. I remember this young man as a baby, Lemuel Bristol. Lemuel hails us from Brooklyn, New York. He's in the Navigator class, and he was part of the first ever Little Lambs class of our Adventurer Club. He likes to play sports, watch movies, and he loves the New York Giants. Okay. Lemuel will be going to college in the fall. He's a senior this year, where he'll be majoring in information technology. After our special music by our own Sydney Charles, stay tuned for the special messages that our Pathfinders have prepared for you.
Wonder why there's so many look the other way. And they say it's in the small things that I can see your love. And I got all these big things and they're messing me up. Maybe it's perspective that could change my mind. And one day all these small things, they will light up every time. Cause that happens all the time.
Seabrook. Please stand so we can pray. Please bow your heads and close your eyes for prayer. Dear Lord, I want to thank you today for letting us be able to gather here so that we may be able to accept this message and apply it in our lives. Please help us have a good rest of this day and a blessed week next week. In your name we pray, amen. You may be seated. Have you ever heard someone say, little means much? If you have, you probably have thought to yourself that the saying is quite similar to a little can go a long way. Or it's like saying to be grateful for whatever you have. When I hear little means much, it makes me think of any small gesture or gift I've ever received in life. Although it may be small, it does mean a lot. In other examples or instances, little means much has been shown throughout the Bible. For example, when David cut out a piece of cloth from Saul's robe, that little piece of cloth signified much more, and both David and Saul knew that. Another example could be when Jesus took the 5 loaves of bread and 2 fishes, and it became plenty, enough for all those who were gathered to hear him speak. These are all examples in the Bible where little has meant much. Little has always meant a lot to me. Throughout my entire life, I've always been told to be grateful for everything I have or to appreciate it, whether it was a gift, a compliment, or even a friendship. But even when I was very young, I've always appreciated when a friend or family member would remember small details about me, like my dream job, favorite color, and even gift preferences. Those small gestures or even acts of remembrance show they care enough to memorize these small details. Although this may not seem like very much to some, to me it meant a lot. And I always appreciated it. So whenever someone tells me small details about themselves or even their birthday, I always try to remember those and express the same positivity that I know I would like to receive in life. Another way little has meant much to me was creation itself. Noticing the small things in life, like every curve in a flower petal or every dent or line in a tree's trunk, means much. It creates detail and sometimes even assists in helping that plant, animal, or whatever it is to do its part. Little means much also can be applied to the lives of children. It's important they understand, although very small, they can make a great impact as well. Just like how David's decision saved the Israelites from their fear of facing Goliath, they can spread the gospel in many ways. It's important they understand their roles as children of God and just how much they can make. Their little lives have just as much importance as those who are adults. Bible verses like Proverbs 22, verse 6, and Psalms 27, verse 3 to 5, explain the importance of raising children in the way of the Lord and the blessing it is to have them, and those are just two examples. There are many more verses that explain and show the impact children have made in biblical times. It just goes to show you just how much change they can make and how little can mean much. One thing I haven't considered when it comes to little means much is how little lies can become big ones. Luke 16, verse 10 says, "Whoever can be trusted with very little can also be trusted with much, and whoever is dishonest with very little will also be dishonest with much." It goes to show you that little means much can be both positive and negative. Whether it's a small kind gesture or a small lie that you may think may never become anything bigger or mean very much. I'm sure you've been told multiple times in life that little lies can become bigger ones, so this is no surprise to hear. But I think it's important to talk about because some people don't realize exactly how big they can become. It's important to try not to fall into the traps of sin and try to always find a way to improve someone's day by being a little more kind with our actions and words.
Sabbath Church. Hi, my name is David. How many of you saw the solar eclipse on Monday? I did, and it was amazing. I wish we were in totality, but I'm satisfied with the experience. Speaking of solar eclipses, the next time there will be a solar eclipse in the United States will be in 2044, which is in 20 years. The universe is a large place with billions of galaxies. The galaxies have billions of stars, and the stars control planets. Most planets are larger than Earth. Jupiter is the largest planet, which is about 11 times larger than the Earth in equilateral diameter. Saturn's the second largest, which is only 10 times larger than the Earth. Uranus is the third largest planet, 4 times larger than the Earth. And Neptune is also 4 times larger. Venus is 94% the size of Earth. Mars is 53% the size of Earth, a little over half the size. And Mercury is 40% the size of Earth. As a 10-year-old kid, I thought that Earth was huge. But the Earth is just a tiny dot compared to the vast universe that we live in. Let's pray. Please stand. Thank you, Jesus, for this day. Thank you for us. Thank you for gathering us here today, and I pray that you may speak to the congregation through me. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Amen. You may be seated. The title of this sermon is Little Means Much. Before we jump in, I want you to think about this question carefully. What is the meaning of a little thing? Well, since it's small, it seems as if its size determines its power and value, but it doesn't. For example, when you smile at a person who's having a bad day, that little smile can change their day in a big way, even if you don't realize it. Now flip to 2 Kings 2, verse 11. It says, "Then it happened, as they continued on and talked, that suddenly a chariot of fire appeared with horses of fire and separated the two of them." Let's stop there for now. Before this happened, Elijah and Elisha had crossed the Jordan. Elisha was a prophet who had prophesied against the evil king Ahab. Remember that king that stole Naboth's graveyard and killed him, who was also married to Queen Jezebel? Yep, that king. See, Elisha had a mantle that he brought everywhere. The mantle will be important later. Let's continue on verse 11. "And Elijah went up by whirlwind into heaven." Verse 12. "And Elisha saw it, and he cried, 'My father, the chariot of Israel and its horsemen.' So he saw him no more. And he took hold of his own clothes and tore them into two pieces." Verse 13. "Also took up the mantle of Elisha that had fallen from him and went back and stood by the bank of the Jordan." Stop there. Elisha, before Elijah had gone up into heaven, had wanted the double portion of Elijah's spirit, but instead got a mantle. He had really hoped for a blessing or something like that, but instead of getting that, he got a mantle which probably wasn't even meant for Elijah. It could have just fallen from Elijah's hand. He was so disappointed, he tore his clothes. Let's read verse 14. "Then he took the mantle of Elisha that had fallen from him and struck the water and said, 'Where is the Lord God of Elijah?' And when he had, and when he also had struck the water, it was divided this way and that, and Elisha crossed over." Wait a minute. The mantle that Elisha had been so disappointed in had been the thing he used to cross over the Jordan. The mantle is insignificant, worthless, and pretty much a little thing. But here you can see that this little thing produced a larger result than expected. Another example is in 2 Kings 4, verses 1 through 7. Verse 1 says, "A certain woman of the wives of the sons of the prophets cried to Elisha, saying, 'Your servant, my husband, is dead, and you know that your servant feared the Lord. And the creditor is coming to take my two sons to be his slaves.'" Verse 2, "So Elisha said to her, 'What shall I do for you? Tell me, what do you have in the house?' And she said, 'Your maidservant has nothing in the house but a jar of oil.' So, have you identified what the little thing is? Well, the little thing is a tiny bit of oil. Now, you know that oil can't pay bills, so it doesn't seem as if a little bit of oil can help now." Let's continue. Verse 3 says, "Then he said, 'Go, borrow vessels from everywhere, from all your neighbors, empty vessels, not gathered, just a few.' Verse 4, 'And when you have come in, you shall shut the door behind you and your sons. Then pour into all those vessels and set aside the full ones.'" So now it seems weird. There isn't a lot of oil, but now Elisha says to get a lot of vessels and pour it into each one. How can a little bit of oil fill many vessels, let alone pay off a creditor with it? Doesn't make any sense logically. But then again, the mantle wasn't seen as good as first, and it worked out. Now let's continue. Verse 5 and 6 says, "So she went from him and shut the door behind her and her sons, who brought the vessels to her, and she poured it. Now it came to pass, when the vessels were full, that she said to her son, 'Bring me another vessel.' And he said to her, 'There is not another vessel.' So the oil ceased." Verse 7, "Then she came and told the man of God. And he said, 'Go, sell the oil and pay your debt, and you and your sons live on the rest.'" So the oil did fill the vessels and pay off the creditor. But guess who did it? God did, by using that insignificant, worthless, and pretty much a little bit of oil. But here we can see again that this little thing produced a larger result than expected. These stories show that God can use anything, whether big or small, to bless us. It also shows that God can use it in more ways than we think. So we need to be more patient, because God often uses unimportant little things to bless people. The thing is, we always expect huge miracles to help us in bad situations. And the reason why is because that's the only thing that can think can help us in bad situations, where things are on the line and the stakes are high. But God doesn't always provide a huge miracle, but he will if it goes according to his will. Sometimes we need to be more aware of the little things in our life. We need to stop expecting huge things to happen every single time we face a bad situation. When Elisha found the use of the mantle, it took away the disappointment of the fact that it was little. Because the mantle finally meant something. It was useful. Elisha must have had a smile on his face as he crossed over the Jordan that day. Little things can mean much, and not just little. A lot of meaning can come from even the smallest thing. Unfortunately, it isn't always positive like in these stories. My last example is about viruses. Viruses are small, so small that you can't see them with your naked eye. And way back during the Middle Ages, people didn't know anything about viruses. And even if they knew, they didn't know it could make a difference. But it meant much, as it made many people sick, and it even led to death. Even today, with all the medical advancements, viruses are still killing people. My hope is that you encounter little things in your life that will be positive. Just remember the little things mean something, and they will make a big difference in your life. Amen.
Happy Sabbath, church family. Let's pray real quick. You don't have to stand. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for bringing us all here today. I thank you that the program has went well so far. I thank you that those two that went before me, they are able to bring your word, and I ask that you help me to do so as well. In your name I pray, amen. Once again, my name is Lemuel Bristol, and my message for today is titled, Are You Crazy? Before I begin, I want to express my appreciation to the pastoral staff, especially Pastor Johnson, and the Pathfinder leaders, Ms. Donna and Mr. Keith, for allowing me to speak to you today. To start, I'd like to ask a simple question. With a show of hands, how many people here have gone through hard times in life? Don't be embarrassed. I know I have. For anyone who didn't raise their hand, I see you. And I only want to see $100 bills when it's time for offering. For all those who did raise their hands, I know we face different challenges, whether they're financial issues, marital problems, depression, or if you just can't seem to pass that class, we've all been in the same boat. Now, let's transition to 1 Kings chapter 17, where we learn about a man in a similar situation to ours. Elisha had been in hiding after his proclamation of no rain to King Ahab. God led him to a brook where he was fed by ravens. For a runaway homeless man, Elisha was living pretty well. He had water to drink whenever he wanted, and the ravens were a personal food delivery service for him, like we have Uber Eats and DoorDash today. After a while, Elijah's luck literally dried up. There had been no rain in the land for quite some time, and I imagine that the brook had been reduced to a muddy trickle. I wonder what Elijah was thinking at that moment, because personally, I would have thought it was the end. Luckily, Elijah's story wasn't over yet. Just as God spoke and worked through him, he wants the same for us. We just have to be quiet and listen. In 1 Kings 17, verse 9, God spoke to Elisha, saying, Arise, go to Zarephath, which belongs to Sidon, and dwell there. See, I have commanded a widow there to provide for you. As we know, God is always right on time, and he wasn't going to let his son go outside. Verse 10, So he arose and went to Zarephath, and when he came to the gate of the city, indeed, a widow was there gathering sticks, and he called to her and said, Please bring me a little water in a cup, that I may drink. Verse 11, And as she was going to get it, he called to her and said, please bring me a morsel of bread in your hand. Now this is where it gets good. The widow must have said to herself, is this man crazy? Does he not know what's going on? It hasn't rained in over 3 years, and this raggedy-looking man who says he's a servant of God is asking me for bread and water? I'm glad the widow held her tongue in that moment because she may have blocked her blessing. As I was reading the story, a personal experience popped into my mind. Is it okay if I get off track for a moment? All right. Okay, great. A couple of months ago, I was out in D.C. with some of my friends. We had just been to an arcade, and I think we were on our way to the movies. The theater was only a couple minutes away, so we decided to walk. On the way there, we saw what appeared to be a homeless man playing a violin on the side of the walkway. He sounded halfway decent, I guess, so we stopped and listened for a while. One or two songs went by, so we decided to leave, but the man wasn't having it. He stepped in front of us and gestured towards the open violin case on the ground with a few dollars inside, implying that he wanted payment for his performance. Two of my friends put a couple dollars inside, but I told him I didn't have any cash on me. Before you start judging, anyone who knows me also knows I never carry cash. I'm a proud Apple Pay warrior. You'd have a better chance of seeing pigs fly before you ever catch me with more than $5 in my wallet. After I said that, I thought I was in the clear, so we started walking past him, but he stepped in front of us again. He gestured for us to wait, reached into his bag, and pulled out a card reader. I don't think I was ever more taken aback in my life. At this point, my friends were dying laughing, because, like, what were the chances of that ever happening? Okay, now we're at the part where you can judge me, because I was dishonest. I told the man I didn't have my card on me when I did. He looked at me and chuckled, and then he pointed to the card reader and said, it's tap too. By then, I knew I'd lost. Of course, I'd be the person to run into a homeless man with a card reader. Like, that never happens. I said, all right, man, you got it. And I tipped him $5. I would have saved myself a lot of trouble if I had just given him the money to begin with. All right, now let's get back on topic. Verse 12 states, she said, as the Lord your God lives, I do not have bread, only a handful of flour in a bin and a little oil in a jar. And see, I am gathering a couple of sticks that I may go in and prepare it for myself and my son, that we may eat it and die. For the widow, all hope had been lost. She'd accepted the fact that her and her son wouldn't make it, and she had all but given up. I'll be going to college in the fall, and at times, the application process has made me feel the same way. Not getting the scholarship I spent days writing the essay for, being waitlisted from a top school, or having terrible student service are all deterrents that sometimes make me want to throw my laptop out the window. And Elijah said to her, do not fear. Go and do as you have said, but make a small cake from it first and bring it to me. And afterward, make some for yourself and your son. For thus says the Lord of Israel, the bin of flour shall not be used up, nor shall the jar of oil run dry, until the day the Lord sends rain on the earth. So she went away and did according to the word of Elijah, and she and her household ate for many days. The bin of flour was not used up, nor did the jar of oil run dry, according to the word of the Lord, which he spoke by Elijah. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. All hope was lost. This woman had planned to eat one last meal and die with her son, but God wasn't done with her yet. Her story wasn't over. It was just beginning. When I learned that the theme of our sermons would be little becomes much, this story immediately popped into my mind. So many of us only have a little strength, courage, patience, or hope yet. But if we offer it up to Jesus, he'll make sure we never run dry. Not many people know this, but I wasn't supposed to be here today. My grandmother passed away recently, and her funeral service is going on as I'm standing here right now. If you ask Miss Donna, she can tell you that originally I told her I wouldn't be able to make it, and that I wasn't in the right frame of mind to finish my sermon. But I'm so thankful that God worked through her to not give up on me. God used her to turn my little into much, and I'm grateful that I can stand before you today. And for everyone here, if you're running on empty, if it feels like all hope is lost, just know your story still has chapters to be written. Now, if anyone can acknowledge that their jar is running low and you want to give it to God, I invite you to stand to your feet. No matter what you're going through, whether big or small, God's got you. He's always got your back. No matter if it may feel like you may not make it, if you might not have enough strength, if you might not be strong enough, you might not have enough money, God's always got you. I have another proposal I'd like to make. If you'd like God to come into your heart and make you new, please come to the front, because I'd like to pray for you. As people are making their way up to the front at this time, I'd like us to sing a special song. It's Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus. It's a simple song, but the message is powerful.
Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full of his wonderful grace. And the things of earth will go strangely dim in the light.
Heavenly Father, I thank you for everyone here today, Jesus. I thank you for everyone that came to be in the presence of you. I thank you for all the messages that came before me, everything that we were able to learn today. And I thank you especially for the theme of little becomes much. Thank you that as you see everyone standing and everyone that came to the front, you know what their problems are. You know what they stand in need of. You know what they may be lacking. You know what they may need. I thank you that even if we may not know it, you always know. And I thank you that we'll always remember that no matter what we're going through, God's got us. No matter what, whether it may seem like you're on your last leg, whether it may seem like all hope is lost, God's got you. Your story isn't over. You're not finished. God has a bigger plan for you, and he'll always come through. I thank you that you will continue to lead us and guide us as we walk in life, and I thank you that you will bless us so that we will be messengers and servants for you. I thank you that you have given me the strength to be able to be here today and bring your word to this beautiful congregation. We thank you and we love you. In your name I pray, amen. You all may be seated.
If you were blessed by the word today, give God some praise. Come on. Our just want to praise God and thank you, Kia, David, and Lemuel, for letting God use you today. You gave me some hope today that little things, things I don't think matter, really matter, and God is going to take it and magnify it and multiply it. And I praise God for that message today. Let's just give God one more hand for the word today through our young people. And not only our young, not only the word, but praise and worship. Every young person who participated, all of our pathfinders and adventurers, can we just praise God? I think we ought to stand and praise God. Come on, come on, come on. Hallelujah. I tell you what, I'm just so proud and filled and thankful for our youth. You know, 2 weeks ago we had our Easter Sabbath service, and the youth led out in that service. And what a blessing, what a blessing. I was blessed by our young people. Every aspect of the service they led out, except the sermon, they led out in. So I just praise God for what God is doing, our young people, and Pathfinder leaders, staff, adventurer leaders, staff. Can we just praise God for the sacrifice, amen, that these individuals are giving week after week, tirelessly, praise God, in working with our young people. And I can, I'm sure I'm not speaking out of turn when I say they can use some help, both men and women, to come on and sign up and participate. Amen? Amen. Amen. I praise God. I praise God. Amen. We're going to worship God in our, I like what you said, Lemuel. I don't know if somebody didn't raise their hand, but even if they, I'm going to raise it up a little bit, though. If you don't have no, you didn't raise your hand, you could give 1,000. Those with hardship, you can do 100. You could do, we're going to, praise God. But we have our Pathfinders who are going to lead us in worship, in giving, amen, at this time. Come on up, Pathfinders, where are you? Come on, come on.
Happy Sabbath, Seabrook. My name is Belicia.
My name is Ashley.
And we are part of the...
Oh. And I'm Isaiah.
And we are part of the Pioneer Navigator class. We are here to talk to you guys about Gillette. Pathfinders is an international organization, part of the SDA Church.
So practically, what we do is just that we just do many activities that helps us get closer to God spiritually, and like some extra activities like drum corps, drill team, dance, and PBE.
Why is Seabrook's Club amazing? Seabrook's Club is amazing because we are social and we can easily relate to others. We're allowed to teach sometimes because we are interested and love participating. That can also be seen in our other groups, as mentioned before, such as our drill team.
So, how can we get involved? So, practically, you can sign your kid up for Pathfinders or volunteering during events and donating. Only a great team is possible with a great support team. That means thank you to everyone who has been supporting the Pathfinders.
So a lot of that support has been seen through the staff that has helped raise all of us practically, and the money that has been given. Again, we have $45,950 raised already for Gillette. However, we still need $26,000 more. The things that we have covered helps us get there, but the rest is for us to be able to stay there comfortably, such as getting tents, wagons to transport gear, and to pay for food, which is something everyone needs. So please, if you can, give. It will definitely benefit us and the community as well. Thank you.
air our your announcements for like the end. So the first announcement is the Let's Go Now Growth Group. This is a growth group geared toward spreading the gospel through literature distribution. Growth group begins today immediately after church in Pastor Munoz's office. In this growth group, you'll learn the basics of friendship, evangelism, how to give hope, inviting others to become disciples, and so much more. To join, click the QR code on the screen and complete the next step card. The second announcement is the Seabrook Community Resource Fair. On Thursday, April 18th, from 6:30 to 8:30 p.m., we are hosting this event on site with Prince George's County Council to showcase the many resources available to community residents. Snacks will be provided along with giveaways and prizes. For more information, click QR codes on the spring or contact Leslie Bridges or Carol Carrington. The third announcement is the summer camp time. This summer is going to be packed with fun for our children and our community. Vacation Bible School is back. It will be held on July 13th and 14th. Please take the time to register in advance. If you are looking for a summer camp for your rising kindergartners to 12-year-olds, Empowerment Camp is just what you've been looking for. Campers will have fun building their relationship with Christ while making new friends. This camp is not just for our children. It also employs our teens, so please support them this summer and invite a friend or neighbor. The last announcement is that lunch is provided for Pathfinder and Adventure members, family, and invited guests immediately after the service in the activity center.
Nakai said, I'm going to get the announcements out of the way before the offering comes. So now I'm going to pray, and then the deacons are coming around with card readers. Thank you, Lemuel, for that story. Gave us a good idea, really good idea. But let me pray. And then the deacons will come. God, we praise you. We thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for the word. Little becomes much when we place it in your hands. Lord, that even applies to the gifts that we give you today. We just don't know how much we bless people, oh God, when we give. So we pray that as we return our tithe, as we give our offering today, that you would magnify it, multiply it, and may many hear and receive and be blessed by your word as a result. We give you the praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. The deacons will now come.
I praise with my life, everything I do, I'll praise.
Amen. We just want to slip one more announcement in there. This Thursday of next week, we have our Community Resources Fair put on by our community leaders, Representative Ingrid Watson and others who will be here. This is for our community. It's from 6:30 to 8:30. So if you have some time Thursday evening, come on out and join us so that we can show that we are supporting this event. We're going to ask you to stand now so we have our benediction.
Pathfinders and Adventurers, parade rest. Prayer attention. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for giving us another day of life. We ask you to help us understand that little means much, meaning that we can do big things in the little things we do, not just for others, but just for you. Thank you for everything you've done in our lives to remember you and to also remember that we need to put you first in everything that we do. In Jesus' name, amen. I pray that the Lord will bless and protect you and to show you mercy and kindness. May the Lord be good to you and give you peace. Amen.
That we know we must share as we grow. Spread the word of God's love wherever we go. It's our mission, it's our charge. We're God's disciples. That's who we are. Serve our neighbors to empower and invite to bother the Creator. His name is Jesus Christ. It's our mission, it's our charge.
Color guards, retrieve colors. Color guards, right face. Color guards, forward. March! Pathfinders and Adventurers, right and left face. Pathfinders and Adventurers, mark time, march! Pathfinders and Adventurers, forward, march!
Amen, church. That concludes our worship service. We want you to have a blessed, blessed Sabbath and blessed week. And we look forward to seeing you next week. God bless. Remember, little things become much in the Lord's hand. God bless you.